according to some research that was done last year in 2016 in the United States, 41% of people in the U.S. made New Year's resolutions. Does anybody have a guess about the number one most common New Year's resolution? Listen, I don't care if it's the U.S. or Kenya, we're all people, right? We all have similar challenges and problems that we face. And so, yes, losing weight was the number one resolution. Anybody have a guess on what percentage of people succeeded at their New Year's resolution? According to this study, it was 9.2%. So about 1 out of 10. There was also a study done last year in Great Britain, and in that one they found that 66% of people failed at keeping their resolution within 1 month, and then 88% of people failed overall. So that kind of coincides with the U.S. research, the British research, in that about 1 in 10 people accomplish their New Year's resolutions, okay? So as a great example of this, it's perfect for us today. There's 10 chairs in each row right here. So maybe if you want to look down your row at everybody else that's there, one of you will succeed. And so if in your row you see some real go-getters, some people that you know are really hard workers, feel free to get up and move right now, because I don't want you to miss out today. The odds are not in our favor, right? It's kind of frustrating, because I don't know about you, but at the beginning of the year, I'm hopeful. I'm excited about what God might have in store for this year. I want to take hold of the promises that I feel like he has spoken to me. I want to grow. I want to become better. There's areas of my life where I know that God is giving me grace to improve, and so I want to see those things change. And so when I hear statistics like 1 in 10 people or 10% of folks are able to honor and keep their New Year's resolution, it's a little bit discouraging, because I wonder, well, what about me? Will I be the 1 in 10? The odds are not in my favor. We've been doing the same study that you guys are doing now, the same sermon series called All In. We've been doing that at the Oaks over the past year. And so again, it's like God is doing such a similar thing with our churches. It feels like home. And in the All In series that we've been doing, the Lord's been speaking to us about this concept of what it means to go all in. And I've learned so much. And so this morning, I don't have it all figured out. I don't have all the answers for you. But I love to share with you from our journey and what God has been teaching us as a church as it relates to going all in. And I think it's a perfect time at the beginning of the new year, because maybe some of you are thinking, man, this year I want to go all in. I don't even know what that means fully, but in 2017, I feel like this is a year where I'm going to step into what God has for me. I'm going to go all in. I'm going to go further than I've gone before. And I don't want your experience to be that of 1 in 10 of you is able to accomplish that. Because I think with God, the odds move way closer to 100% for anyone that would say yes. And I think there's a few keys to be able to do that and to change those odds from 1 in 10 to 100% to anyone who says yes. And so today I just want to share what we've been learning. Would that be okay? About what it takes to go all in. What does that mean? And how do we succeed in that so that it's not just a good intention at the beginning of the year, but it's actually a lifestyle that we're able to embrace, to experience all that God has for us. And so I'm going to look today together with you at Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. I'm going to read out of the New International Version. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. When I was with you in July, the passage that I was preaching on began with the same word as this passage. I actually remember saying the same thing that I'm about to say to you right now in July, because the first word of this passage is what? Therefore. And when there's a therefore, you have to ask yourself, what is the therefore, therefore? Because it means he's not starting a new idea. He's actually taking what he's been saying to us, he's building on that, and now he's going to kind of tell us what to do as a result of everything that he's shared. So we know that Paul is the author of Romans. And in Romans chapter 12, he starts off by saying, therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters. And I feel like if it's okay, I'm going to stand in as Paul to you today. And I'm going to look at you and say, my brothers and sisters, I urge you, therefore, in view of God's mercy. So Paul is summarizing. I think he's beginning this chapter by saying, hey, this is 12 chapters into the letter that I'm writing to you. There's a lot of other stuff I've said, and I need you to remember everything I've told you before I tell you anything else. Because what I'm about to tell you, if you don't keep in mind what I've said, you're going to misunderstand what I'm trying to say. Does that make sense? And so as we go back and we look at Romans, in the beginning of Romans, Romans chapter 1, Paul makes a very bold statement. He says, the righteous will live by what? By faith. The righteous will live by faith. That's how Romans begins. And then it goes through where we find out that we've all sinned, we've all blown it, but that God, his gracious gift, it brings eternal life. We find out in Romans chapters 5 through 7 that we died to sin, and that it's no longer sin that we are connected to, but it's Christ. He gives the illustration in Romans chapter 7 that it's like we're a woman whose husband died, and now because the husband died, she's free to remarry someone else. And so it's like the law. We died to the law, and now we are free to be united to another, to Jesus, to the one who was raised from the dead. So that our identity changed. We're no longer bound to live in a lifestyle that's based on our own effort and our performance and our ability to keep a list of rules, but it's based on now Christ and his performance and his life and what he's accomplished for us. And then he gets to Romans 8 where he says, listen, because of that, there's no longer any condemnation for any of us who are in Christ Jesus. He says, good news. There's no longer any need for guilt and shame. Things have changed now because of what Jesus has done. At the end of Romans 7, he said, listen, at one point I lived as a man who all the things that I wanted to do that I knew I should do, I couldn't do them. And all the things that I knew I shouldn't do, that's what I kept doing. But God set me free. And now I live free of this condemnation. In fact, he goes on and he says, I'm now adopted as a son of the Most High God, and I actually get to call him Abba. I get to call him Daddy, this awesome King of Kings and Lord of Lords that we were worshiping earlier today. Paul says we also get to call him Papa. And then he says, if he is for us, who can be against us? Can anything separate us from his love? In fact, God who gave us his son, will he not also give us all things? And then in Romans 9 through 11, he talks about how even when the plans and the promises of God don't match what we see with our eyes, and it doesn't make sense what's happening right now in comparison to what God has said, we can trust that what God has said, his plans and his promises will prevail. So therefore, in view of God's mercy, in view of the fact that this is not about you, in view of the fact that you're dead to the performance system that has to do with the law, and you are now alive, and actually the life of Christ is living through you, in view of his mercy, in view of all of these things, now I have something to say. Okay? Everybody on the same page? Feel good about that? So, he goes on to say this. Offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Now, I've grown a lot, even as a pastor. I look back even a few years ago, and there are messages that I taught where I look back and I say, oh no, that's not right. I'm sorry to the people that I preach those messages to. I'm learning and I'm growing, and God is teaching me new things every year, and he's showing me more about who he is. And that's one of the great delights of my life, is that for the rest of my life, and actually for the rest of eternity, we're going to learn more about who he is. We don't ever arrive. We don't ever have him figured out. So that's kind of a fun discovery. And so how I used to read this passage is quite different from how I read it now. So is it okay if I share with you my previous view, which I don't hold to anymore? Offer your body as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Here's how I understood that before. And maybe some of you heard it this way this morning. Because God did all these things for you, you need to sacrifice everything for him. You need to put yourself to death. You need to put yourself on the altar. You need to crucify every aspect of who you are, and you need to strive to live a life that is holy and pleasing to Him, because this is, look at what all He's done for you. This is just reasonable that you would do this in response. Okay? That's how I used to read it. Can I share how I read it now? In view of God's mercy, in realizing the fact that He has done so much for you, things you could never, ever, ever do for yourself, and you really can't add to it, offer yourself to Him as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing. Not meaning that you strive to be holy and pleasing, but that you actually come before God and you say, Daddy, here I am. And I'm holy and I'm pleasing to You today, right now, in this moment, not because of anything that I've done, but because of what You've done for me, Jesus, and because who You've made me and how You've cleansed me and how You've washed me and how You've given me a new identity, and it's rooted in You. And so today, God, as my true and proper act of worship, I just accept everything that You said about me, and I come before You holy and pleasing. Have Your way in my life. That's a little scary. I'll be honest, even for a pastor, that's a little scary. Let me tell you why. As soon as I start saying that, you know what goes on in my head? Well, I don't know if you're really that pleasing to God. I mean, you really have kind of slacked off the last few days in reading the Bible. If you had done better, then maybe you could say that you're pleasing. But there's a lot of things that you know you should have done that you didn't do. So can you really stand there and say that you're pleasing to God? It seems like a little bit of a stretch. Or it could be, depending on what's going on in my life, a sin from yesterday that comes to mind, and I hear a voice that says, you're not holy. What do you think you're doing? That's arrogant. God's going to strike you down for saying that. That's a straight up lie. I can't believe you go before God and say, here I am, God, I'm holy. I think that voice is an accusing voice. In fact, the Bible says that there is one whose name is the accuser, and it says his voice and his words are lies. I wonder if what Paul is saying here is that the greatest response, the greatest act of worship that we can give to the Lord is a sacrifice of submitting our thoughts and our perception of ourselves, our awareness of our failure, our awareness of our inadequacy, the things that we should have done and that we didn't, the things that we did that we should not have done. What if the greatest act of worship is to bring all of those things and to come before Him, to sacrifice those and to put them aside and to come in humility before Him and say, God, it doesn't even make sense and I'm not worthy of it, but I come before You and I declare, God, that I worship You as my daddy, God, and I come before You holy and pleasing because that's how You see me. That's what You say. That's what You've done. And I believe You and I take You up on that. And there's an intimacy and there's a confidence and there's a joy and there's a freedom that comes from that place. What if it's that it's not about the striving, but rather in view of God's mercy, in view of everything He's already said, it's about the confidence of coming before God and not just in a moment. Though I think it starts in a moment. I think that moment is now. Because we always say, at least for me, I think, well, yeah, that's good. That sounds right. As soon as I get this figured in my life, then I'll step into it. As soon as I break this bad habit, then I can do that. But I think the power of this word, the power of the gospel, is that it's a moment, and that moment is now. But then it's also a lifestyle. It's a place that remains open to us. It's a place where we can stay, where we can encounter God, where we can live our life out of a place of rest. And I think at the beginning of this year, a year where many of us start with resolutions and things that we want to see, I think God is reminding us that this is not a year about striving. It's a year of surrender. It's not a year of our performance, but it's a year of purposing to submit ourselves to God and to rest in Him. And from that place, He gives us all things. It's like this. Let's say there's somebody that worked all of their life and they saved and they saved and they saved and they saved their money and their plan was to build their dream retirement home. But they meet you one day and at the end of the conversation they say, you know, I've been saving up all this money and I've built my dream retirement home, but I feel like I need to give it to you. So here's the keys. And it gives me great joy to do this. I hope you enjoy it. I hope you love it. Which would bring more joy to that person who is sacrificing? A person who responded like this, number one, oh, wow, that's incredible. I don't deserve this. What can I do to serve you? I need to do all these things for you. What can I do to help you? I thank you for this. This is a beautiful home. I really like it, but I don't deserve it. So here are all the things that I'm going to do to serve you. How can I make you happy? And they never actually go in the house because they're too concerned with pleasing and earning that gift that was given. Or option two is the person who receives it and says, oh my gosh, I don't even know what to say. There's no words. I could have never afforded this. I could have never done this for myself. You're an incredible person. And they turn the key and they go in and they celebrate and they're so happy. And that joy brings actually joy to the person who had given that gift to them. Which one is actually a source of greater humility and joyfulness and gratefulness? It's the second option, right? God has created, he's created a space for you in his throne room where you have access to come before him because of what Jesus has done. And he gives us the keys, and it cost him everything. It cost him the life of his son on the cross. It wasn't cheap. It was a great sacrifice. And maybe we think, well, that's so nice. I see that and I believe that's true, but I don't deserve that. And so I'm going to work and I'm going to strive. And here, what are all the do you want me to do, God, in order to earn this? What are all the things that I can do to serve you? What are all the Christian activities that I can do to show you that maybe I'm worth what you've done? Instead of just saying, God, it has nothing to do with me, and I don't even understand why you love me so much and why you're so crazy about me, but I'm just going to believe what you said because I believe that you're good and I believe your word is true, and I'm just going to take a step of faith because the righteous live by faith, and I'm going to come in and I'm just going to start this new year by saying, here I am, God, at the start of 2017, holy and pleasing to you, and from that place there's freedom and there's confidence and there's a boldness that comes from which we can face the new year out of intimacy with the one who loves us so. In verse 2, it says this: do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. Can I share with you how I used to read this? I used to read this like this: do not conform to the pattern of this world, meaning stop sinning, get it right. Stop doing wrong things, but be transformed. Come on, get it right. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. So if I stop sinning and if I get it right, then God will tell me what he wants me to do. He'll tell me what to do in this situation. He'll guide me as I'm trying to figure out what university or what job or how to handle the situation in my finances or my family. If I do good enough and I stop sinning, he'll show me his good, pleasing, and perfect will. That's how I used to read it. Can I tell you how I read it now? Do not conform to the pattern of this world. Since Paul is throwing that therefore in there, in view of God's mercy, I wonder if he's not talking about sin necessarily when he says the pattern of this world. I wonder if what he means by the pattern of this world is the way the world thinks and operates. What I've noticed and what we're probably all taught from a very young age is that the way the world works is totally based on our own performance. So if you do well in school, you get into a better next school. And if you get into a better next school, you go to a better university. If you go to a better university, you get a better job that pays more, that gives you prestige, and it gives you the things, and you have a great family and all these. So it's all about, if I do well, then I get this. That's the pattern of this world. That's how our societies tend to function. And we're taught that from a young age, whether verbally or just by the way things work. And I wonder if what Paul is saying, because all he's done in Romans 1 through 11 is talk about how it has nothing to do with us and everything to do with Jesus. And that it's all by faith and stepping in by faith to receive what he's done. I wonder if what he's saying is, do not conform to the pattern of the world where you think it's all about what you can do. Rather, be transformed by the renewing of your mind and coming into agreement with what God says about you and what he has accomplished for you on the cross through his death and through his resurrection and through his intercession at the right hand of God. Come into alignment with that thinking. And as you do that, I actually like a different translation, the way it translates this. The New King James Version says it this way: and do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. I think that's a more accurate translation. So what that means is this: I don't think it's all about me anymore and my striving and I'm just putting my head down trying to make things happen, but rather I look to you. I don't look at myself. I look to you, Father, and what you provide for me, and I step by faith into this place where I'm saying, Daddy, here I am, holy and pleasing to you because of what you've done. And in that place, you actually prove to the rest of the world what is the good and pleasing and perfect will of God. Because what is his will other than to have other sons and daughters come into that place of intimacy with him? But it starts not through just declaring something. It starts by us being something. It starts by us taking a step to go all in and say, God, here I am, holy and pleasing to you. And in this place of freedom, God, I'm actually proving what your will is to those that are around me, that they would look and see that there's a God that loves them. There's a God that's good. There's a God that can be trusted, and there's freedom, and there's joy, and the burdens of this life, and the pressure that we put on ourselves, there's freedom from that too, because Jesus said, my yoke is easy, and my burden is light, and we can actually do something with that that impacts the kingdom of God just by being a certain type of person who understands who God is and who we are in his sight. So if there's one thing that I want to communicate to you today, sometimes I've heard a message and somebody asked me, how was church today? Oh, it was good. How was the message? Oh, it was really, really good. What was it about? I have no idea. So in case someone asks you today, what was the message about today at ICC? Here is the answer, okay? I'm going to make it really easy for you. Here's what you tell them. Here's the main point. Going all in isn't about what you can do for God, but about fully trusting what he has done for you. Going all in isn't about what you can do for God, but about fully trusting what he has done for you. As we've been going through the All In series at the Oaks, there was an illustration that we kept coming back to time and time again because I think it's a really poignant illustration of this concept. In 1859, so this is going back sometime in the United States, there was a man named Charles Blondin. And Charles Blondin was very famous for one thing. There's a huge waterfall in the United States between Canada in the United States, actually, called Niagara Falls. It's like the Victoria Falls of the United States. And Charles Blondin took a tightrope, and he stretched it out across Niagara Falls, hundreds of feet in the air. It was 350 meters long. And he was famous because people would come from far and wide to see Charles Blondin walk across this tightrope that was stretched 350 meters, hundreds of feet in the air, over one of the largest waterfalls in North America. And so people would come and they would cheer and they would be amazed. But as you know, we quickly grow tired of just the one thing. We need to escalate. Things need to get bigger and better, right? And so Charles Blondin was famous because he would always add things into the mix. So he would say, hey, do you believe that I can do this blindfolded? And the crowd would cheer, yes. And so he would put a blindfold on and he would walk across the tightrope. I can't even pretend to walk across the ground with my eyes closed without stumbling. So it's amazing what he did, right? And then he gets to the other side and he says, do you believe that I can walk across this tightrope wearing stilts? And the people said, yes, we believe. And so he would put the stilts on and he went across the tightrope. My favorite story about him, and this is true, you can Google this, you can look it up. He walked across the tightrope one time with a stove, got out to the middle of the 350-meter tightrope, cooked an omelet and ate it, and then continued on the rest of the way. I mean, he's just showing off. So he continued to escalate things until one day, I'm going to make it hard for the video guy to follow me right now. He had a wheelbarrow. And he filled the wheelbarrow with sacks of potatoes. And he said to the crowd, do you believe that I can walk across this tightrope with this wheelbarrow? And the crowd said, yes, we believe. And so he went across the tightrope, pushing the potatoes in the wheelbarrow. And he got to the other side, and everyone cheered and shouted because it was the most incredible thing that they'd ever seen. And then he asked them a question. He said, do you believe that I can put a man in this wheelbarrow and walk across this tightrope? And the crowd said, yes, we believe, we believe. And then he asked them a question. Who will be that man? The story goes that no one said yes. Because it's one thing to, from the sidelines, look and say, yes, we believe. It's another thing, get in the wheelbarrow, to be totally at the mercy of someone else, to be totally helpless. You can stand on the sidelines, you can tell the stories, you can see it with your own eyes, you can go tell your friends everything that you saw and everything that you heard. But until you get in the wheelbarrow, you haven't fully trusted him. And I think sometimes we do that when it comes to the Lord. We see what he's done for us. We acknowledge the cross. We acknowledge his forgiveness. We acknowledge his grace. We can tell other people about it. We can celebrate it. Sometimes we can do that without fully embracing it, without fully saying, God, I'm in. I'm 100% in. I am totally at your mercy. I'm totally helpless without you. We'll say, yes, God, I totally accept your forgiveness, but then we'll do a bunch of Christian activity to try to earn it. We'll say, yes, God, I believe that if I put first your kingdom and I give and I invest and I tithe and I give generously, I believe that you're going to bless me and provide for all of my needs. But this month is kind of tight, so I'm going to start next month. So we acknowledge his goodness, but we don't quite step all the way in. Totally at his mercy. Totally trusting. I could go on and on and on with the types and the illustrations of what that might mean for each of us, because I'm sure there's different applications. Each one of us might struggle in a different area in that way. But as we begin this new year, and as we're in this all-in series, I want to encourage you to let this not be a year of striving, but a year of surrender. A year where you don't start with your own effort, but you start by fully trusting. Because remember, it's not about what I can do for God, but by fully trusting what he has done for me. So for some of you today, that might mean that you've been a Christian for a while. It might mean you've been coming to ICC for years. But as I'm talking, you might say, you know, I can talk all about it. I've heard all about it. I can tell people all about it, but when it comes down to it, I don't know that I totally have trusted God, that he has saved me. I don't know that I have the confidence today that I could come before the Father and say, here I am, holy and pleasing to you. Because when I say that, it feels like such a lie that it's not even worth uttering those words out of my mouth. And I feel like today God wants to change that, and he wants you to walk out of here with confidence, the confidence that not only for a moment now, but for a lifestyle, you can stay in this place and say, God, here I am, holy and pleasing to you. And there's a joy and there's a freedom that comes from that. I also felt like some of you, you've done that, you're trusting him, but even as you begin a new year and all the things you want to accomplish, there's a heaviness to it, there's a weightiness to it. And Jesus said, come to me, because my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Learn my ways. I'm humble and gentle. And I think for some of you, what the Lord wants to do today is he wants to restore the joy of your salvation. Listen, the gospel means the good news, right? This is the greatest news in the world. Like, I can't even do it justice. What I'm telling you today, he's so much better than I'm even able to articulate. And the gospel is so much more powerful than we can even comprehend. And so what I'm saying to you today is that the gospel is full of joy. And it should fill us with joy. And if it's not filling you with joy anymore, it might be because you've added in some weight to the process. You're trying to add to what Jesus has already done. And I'm here to say today is a new day where God is going to renew the joy of your salvation, because it's not about you, it's about him. And just by going all in, and it's scary and it takes courage and it takes boldness to step past the fear, it takes courage to step past the voice of the accuser in our minds and to say, that's a lie. God has said that he has made me holy and pleasing to him, and I'm going to prove it to the rest of the world by standing in this place with confidence, not because I deserve it, not because of anything that I've done, but because it's the best thing that I can do to worship him is to accept what he says, to step into that place, because the righteous live by faith. So why don't we stand together today as we close? I'm prophetically declaring over you today that this message and what God wants to do in you this year is not for just 1 out of 10 of you. This is not for one person in your row to succeed in this. This is for each of us today. And here's the craziest part. All we have to do is say yes. We don't have to push the wheelbarrow. We don't have to be the one that has the skills. All we have to do is get in and trust that the person who's driving knows what he's doing. All we need to do is trust that what Jesus did is enough to make you holy and righteous. All you need to do is trust that as you step out in faith and you serve and you give and you do whatever it is that God is telling you to do this year, that you do it from that place of intimacy with him that comes with the confidence and the joy of knowing that it's no longer you who live, but you have been crucified with Christ, and now it's his life that's working through you. That's what Galatians talks about. And so I want to ask you two questions. The first question is this. If you've been coming to church for a while, or maybe this is even the first time, you're hearing this message for the first time, and you're like, I didn't even know what the gospel was. You're telling me that's the gospel, that because of what Jesus has done, I can be holy and righteous and have the confidence to approach God? Yep, that's it. It's good news. It brings freedom. It brings life. And out of that place, we become new people, and we live a different kind of way. Not because we're striving to, but because he makes us that way. He enables us to do it. And so here's my first question. Maybe you've been here for a long time. Maybe you're here for the first time, but you say, I need that. I want that. I want to go all in trusting him, that he is the one who makes me righteous, that he is the one who gives me access, and that today I want to stand before the Father and say, here I am, clean of all of my sins, forgiven, joyful, and in a place where I can listen to his voice and respond to prove to the rest of the world who our Father is.
Welcome to Vision Television, where truth counts.